Thank you, and good afternoon, everybody. For those of you who are joining us from afar, it is 5 o'clock on Sunday here in Woods Hole, Massachusetts. It's a beautiful sunny day. This is day two of the 29th Woods Hole Film Festival, and this is our first virtual edition, done so in response to the global pandemic. However, we could not be more thrilled with the festival that we have in front of us, which spools out for the entire week, runs through August 1st. We hope that you will have a chance to see all of the amazing films in the collection this year. The Woods Hole Film Festival is dedicated to presenting the best in emerging independent film. And as I mentioned, we get films submitted to us from around the world. We select films that have stories that are interesting, compelling, funny, sad, that they run the gamut. But our interest in is also in helping filmmakers to have the ability to have a platform to show their work before audiences who appreciate it so much. We hope that next year we will gather again in Woods Hole and also keep the virtual festival alive. So just, we could not do this without all the support we receive from our sponsors, from our granting funders, from festival donors and friends, and from the amazing staff who has worked literally round the clock for the last 3 months to make this particular virtual festival happen. So we're gonna get started. As the host mentioned, if you have a question, please write it into the Q&A. And we will try and get to everybody. This Q&A will run for about 45 minutes, and then it is being recorded. It will be posted online on YouTube afterward. I would also just like to remind you that in this festival, each film is eligible for both an audience and a jury award. When you watch the films, you can vote for them right there in the streaming platform. So we hope you'll take the opportunity to do that. The awards will be announced on Sunday, August 2nd, streaming live on Facebook. So without further ado, I want to bring in the filmmaker for the film that we're discussing today, which is called Sheep Hero. So Tan got up either very early or very late, depending on which way you look at it. So Tan is in the Netherlands, and I'm going to let him introduce himself. We're going to talk a little bit about the genesis of this film. But first, Tan, I don't speak Dutch, so pronounce your last name for us and give us an idea what time it is for you right now.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ton van Zandvoort. When I'm in a foreign country, I always say Tom because that's more easy to pronounce, but it's with an N. And as you might see, I'm a bit tired. It's late in the evening, but I also had a rough day working, so physically tired. It's about 11:15 now. In the Netherlands, I'm based in Breda, near the Belgian border.
Wonderful. And so you've made a lot of films over your career, but how did you come to this story? Where did it come from? How long did you work on it? Sort of what's your relationship to the subjects of the film? Because as I understand it, you do have a personal connection with them.
Yeah, it's a long story. I made quite some films, but I actually made one film about this same guy as well. And that's how I came with this film. So in 2010, I made a short film about the shepherd. Back then, I didn't know there were still shepherds in the Netherlands, but there were. And then I made a short film, 15 minutes, and I didn't see him for a long time. And when I saw him again, I didn't recognize him because he lost his hair. He didn't have hair. So I asked, okay, do you have a new hairdress? And he said, no, I my hair just fall out. I went to the doctor and the doctor said, well, it must be because of the stress, because he was so stressed up. His hair was falling out. And the doctor actually said to him, you should go more into nature and relax. And the fact that the doctor said to a shepherd that he had to go into nature and relax more that was for me the starting point of this film. I thought, okay, how can it be that a modern shepherd nowadays is so much stressed? So that's the starting point of this film.
And so how many years did you work on it before it took shape and became the film that you released in 2018?
Yeah, well, filmmaking takes a long time. It's the financing. And when I first started this film, people said, you're going to make a film about a shepherd? That's boring. And so I had to convince them, no, it will not be boring. So it takes a long time before you have the financing. And then you start filming. I did most of the things myself. So I shot it. I also edited it. And that's really hard to edit your own film. So I also had to take a lot of breaks. So I filmed for two years almost, with breaks, of course, and also edited it for 2.5 years. I also started editing during shooting. And I had 80 versions. A lot of two picture locks, a lot of things happen. So it takes a long time.
But, you know, when you work on something for so long and you're immersed in the story itself, I think oftentimes filmmakers become attached to the story and to the subject in a way that they really align themselves with what's happening, and it affects them personally as well. It's hard to be distant and objective when you're around somebody for such a long time. And you know, this story is not an easy story. For those of you who have seen the film, you know that. If you haven't seen the film, I hope that you will. It is available throughout the rest of the festival week. But it's not an easy story, because we're used to thinking of people who work in the agricultural sector, such as shepherds, and most of us really probably don't know shepherds anymore, as people who live kind of a throwback existence where everything is easy, you're living next to the land. Yes, you work hard, but it's a very elemental existence. And I think what this film shows more than anything is that what may have seemed like it was easy and a way that, you know, we only hearken back to the ability to live that way is not that at all. And issues come up that really are associated with the struggles so many people are facing today, such as how to work in what they want to be doing in this economy when it's becoming much more difficult for the individual and the small business to exist independently without having a conglomerate or a big company come in and try and muscle them out. And so, you know, obviously I would imagine that's where the title Sheep Hero comes from, but maybe you want to sort of talk about that. Like, this isn't just a story about a shepherd. This is a much broader story, if you want to sort of give us some insight into that.
Yeah, well, that's true. For me, I always try to make universal stories, because for me, the shepherd, I mean, it's also a symbol for a romantic, one of the oldest jobs in the world as well. But what you said in the beginning, that our relationship, I see a lot of similarities between the shepherd and me, also working in a profession that is also quite uncertain. We have the same age, we have the same rebel character. We also want to change the world, but he goes a step further in that. So that also made the editing quite difficult, because I really love the guy, because I really know where all the shit and the problems are coming from that he's facing. But so when I had a version of 3 hours, and you saw so much of his rough side. He was yelling and shouting, so people were quite shocked and afraid of him. And I thought, that was for me a sign, okay, then the edit is out of balance, because that's not how I want to show it, and that's not the truth as well. For me, it's about David versus Goliath. I always try to tell universal stories, but of course it's difficult when you film a shepherd, because people do see a shepherd, and with a head and the sheep. But for me, it's a universal story about that it's nowadays very hard, at least in the Netherlands, and I think in a lot of places, to compete in this neoliberal system. So it's not that difficult to be a shepherd and living from the land, but he has two children. They have to go to school. When you go to school, you have certain rules. You need to have a laptop. You need to have money to buy the laptop. So you always, you're forced in the system, and you have to be a part in that. And also the shepherd in the Netherlands, he doesn't, it's really hard, the sheep, he has to live from his sheep. So he was making his money by grazing the heathlands for biodiversity. But then indeed, it's the free market. So when there are bigger companies coming with more sheep, and they use different systems, like they put sheep in nets, and they just replace them. I mean, it's a long time ago, but it's difficult to explain all the differences, but it's unfair competition, what they are doing. And then it's really hard as a simple man to...
I mean, I think it's probably, that. And I don't really know the economic system in the Netherlands. Maybe you can sort of talk about that a little bit, but, you know, in the United States, it's akin to small independent farmer, you know, it takes a lot of effort. It's not just farming that's required to survive. You have to be able to survive in the business sphere that you're in. And being able to sort of survive against the elements, it takes so much energy when all you really want to be doing is working on your farm. You have to become political. You have to become active. You have to be aware, and you have to be available to speak up for yourself, because other people aren't going to do it. And so if you can sort of give us some idea, for those of us who don't really know much about the economic system in the Netherlands with regard to food and how the food economy works, maybe you can give us a little bit of background. Where would a shepherd fit into that, and what are the protections and the difficulties that an independent farmer would face?
Yeah, well, I think when you're talking about food, I think the food chain is controlled by four companies. I once heard, like the Monsanto in the beginning with the seed, and the supermarket in the end. And to be as a single shepherd, to be part of in that, it's really hard. In the Netherlands, more and more people are becoming aware, and they want to have good produced food locally. But still, when you see the regulations you had to comply with, it's really hard to make money. To give an example, the shepherds in the Netherlands, they were losing 30,000 euros a year. But it was not only him, because his wife was helping, his father and his mother were helping, and there were 10 volunteers to keep that business running. So when you're talking about business, it's not, you know, it's not a business. It's not profitable, and that's why it's dying out. So in the Netherlands, what the shepherds were living from was sort of subsidies they could get for grazing the heathlands for biodiversity. And that's what I just said before, is that also in that part, bigger companies saw, okay, profit, we have our sheep for meat, hey, but we can earn some extra money in the summer to have them grazing over there. So a lot of the shepherds, they just fall, they just went bankrupt, the traditional ones. So you have to be bigger, better, I'm saying this because in the beginning you see him shaving on a song of Daft Punk, bigger, better, faster, stronger. And that's a bit for me what the film is about. And that's the economy I think you have in the States as well. And in the Netherlands, I mean, the whole world is capitalism and neoliberal system, I think. Almost so.
Yeah, bigger, better, faster, stronger, and then what? You know, it's dog. So,
and then you get a heart attack and you fall down, right? Like the shepherd, he got bald and really stressed, and yeah.
But so, you know, we're talking about sort of a way of life. I mean, this is not just relevant to somebody who's a shepherd. This is relevant to so many people who work in so many different aspects of whether it's food, whether it's the creative world. I mean, so you as a filmmaker, you said initially you could really relate because you kind of feel like that's how you have to live as well. And so many filmmakers probably do relate to that, especially people who make independent films. It's passion. You make it because you have to and you want to. You're not making it as a corporate video. So what do you think from your own perspective, making a film like this, like how has it been received? Where has it been? What's its life?
Yeah, well, the first part you said about relating, there's one thing more I want to say about that, because I was indeed, he was sometimes complaining, and then I said, well, it's the same for me, you know. I also don't know where I will be, what job I will do next year. But then he said, okay, but when you don't have work, you just put your camera and put it in the closet. And I have a lot of sheep, 500, or at a certain point he had 2,000. And if I don't know where I can go next year with my cattle, then, you know, then or I'm being pushed away from a grazing area, I have to kill the animals. And that's one of the biggest difficult differences there is. The second part you asked, where the film went.
Yeah. So, you know, you worked for a long time to make this film, you put your heart and soul into it.
Yeah.
It is kind of how you are as a filmmaker, how most independent filmmakers are. But then once the film is done, it's not like it's done and you put it on a shelf. You don't bring it out the field. It has a life of its own. So
yeah.
Tell us a little bit about what you've done with it. How have people reacted when you, back when, you know, we could show films before live audiences?
Yeah. I'm really happy and honored that the film went this, for me, like, worldwide, about 90 festivals, of which also quite big A festivals, theatrical release in the Netherlands, and also France is coming in September, October, Belgium, screenings on television in some countries. So I really, you always hope it, you know, every film you make, you think, okay, this will be big. But with this film, I hoped it, but I didn't expect it, because it's about a Dutch shepherd, you know, who I made other films that I thought were more universal, but apparently people can relate with this topic. And the reactions are good overall, but it's also interesting to see different sort of reactions in different cultures. And it already happened in the Netherlands, which is really tiny, a really small country. But in the south of the Netherlands, that's where the film is made, we have a certain culture that is more rough. You know, we are more direct, and in the north, people were already a bit sometimes shocked about that. But for example, if you see in Greece, the reactions were, for example, about in one scene, he's getting a fine because there are a few sheep droppings on the pavement. The fact that you know, he had to move his sheep, and he got a fine to that he didn't clean them. And in Greece, people, when they see a shepherd, they go to the street and they collect the sheep droppings to fertilize their land. So it's the opposite world, and that's how it was in the Netherlands as well. So really, I'm really happy and really honored, and it did really good in the eastern part of Europe as well. And I also think because they have more shepherds there still, and they are also seeing the same issues that the shepherd in the Netherlands is facing, that the whole country is you cannot go through the streets anymore, the regulations. And so that's also where people can
So before
sorry for my English. It's been a while, and I'm here in quarantine, and so I hope you'll understand.
But before we open it up for questions from people who have joined us, and if you joined us late, if you have questions, feel free to type them in the Q&A, and I will read them, and we'll talk about them. But film came out in 2018. It seems like the political atmosphere, and I don't know this, I'm just making an assumption, might be a lot different now. Do you feel like his life would be more difficult or less difficult trying to do what he wants to do?
What do you mean with the political?
At least economically, I don't know if there's the same kind of recession, if there's the same kind of challenge in the Netherlands as there is in the United States, but also it seems like, at least in many sectors here, there is a growing and increasing recognition that food security also means things should be done and grown locally, and that it's not just about big ag and big companies. And I wonder if that kind of thinking has also impacted the Netherlands or Europe in general, so that he is more able to keep being a shepherd.
Yeah. So I cannot, not everyone saw the film, I think, yeah?
We don't know.
Oh, no, but is that why, because can I?
Yeah.
Alert. So if you haven't seen the film now, pause this Q&A and come back later. I will now do a spoiler alert. Because in the end of the film, he stops being a shepherd because it's not he's not able anymore. And since then, a lot of things have changed. The film did have impact a bit politically. So there are some rules and regulations that changed that would make it more easy. But for the main character of the film, it's not the... It's not enough anymore, because he then quit. In the end of the film, you think he's going to be a shepherd in France, but he wasn't able to take his sheep with him. So they were all, or most of them were slaughtered. And he went to France, but he came back after 4 months already. He did some shepherding in the Pyrenees, in the mountains in France. But then his father got cancer. He's also in the film. And he died recently after that. So that was really hard. So the place that they are living in the film, that they don't have it anymore. And they came back to the Netherlands, but they didn't have any place to live. And he often said to me, well, leaving the Netherlands is not so difficult, but coming back, you know, you don't have rights on anything. So you don't have a job, but you cannot live anywhere. So they even stayed with one of the volunteers, but that didn't work out because with the children and stuff. So they had, it's really, is that my sound maybe? Because then I will put this
on. Okay.
Yeah. And now they're living in the north of the Netherlands in a small renting house. And for me, I mean, he's happy, I think, there. But for me, it was a bit like his worst nightmare coming true, or at least that's what we were talking about years before. He said going to live like everyone does in 13 in a dozen, you know. When I started to make the film, I also thought that would be a beginning shot of the film, that you see like all the same houses with all the same, you know, like in American Beauty, when it opens, you see the shot, because that's how we are supposed to live, you know. And when someone is a bit different or you want to be a bit rebel, it's getting more and more hard. So the film ends sad, and the reality, I think, yeah, it's even more sad. And also after him, it's not only him, because more the traditional shepherds, they all yeah, a lot of them.
Well, that's what I was going to say. I mean, I think this film probably applies to so many different kinds of people who are trying to live like they want to live.
Yeah.
And trying to live in a way that doesn't conform necessarily to a modern economy or other people's expectations of how you're supposed to be. And so you get crowded out, both literally in terms of space, but also in terms of how you can fit in and how you can be nimble enough to still be able to do what you want to do in the face of so much difficulty. So what is he actually doing now if he's not a shepherd?
The last I heard, he didn't have a job, and he's now taking care of the children and his wife, Anna. She was milking some cows and doing some cleaning with elderly people. I don't think they're really sad, but he is. But I'm sad because it's, you know, you want those people just to have their to just give them their I think it's a pity that. Yeah. But he's always positive, and he always says I can do everything, and he will do everything, and so a lot of
people in the audience, don't be shy, please ask some questions if you would like. Otherwise, I'll just keep going. I'm sure my questions are so brilliant. So. Have you made another film since this one?
No. I mean, filmmaking for me takes a really long time, and I also produce films. So I was producing two films. One just finished, and I did have another subject that I was researching, but then I didn't get the access to film it, and then Corona, the COVID came, so I couldn't go there. And now I'm developing a new film, but I think the financing in the Netherlands goes different than in the States. But in the Netherlands, it does take a long time, and I'm really busy doing a lot of things, and I'm also doing some corporate things too. I have to pay the rent as well.
A lot of documentary filmmakers, you know, they make films about subjects, not people, but topics that that have a broad interest and that many people want to know about, but they may not know about it exactly when the film comes out. And so many filmmakers create impact campaigns, or a film has a life of its own, and sometimes it spools out over many, many years. And then you, as a filmmaker, you're living with that project for a long time, and you are the keeper of that project. And so you're living in that story, even as you're trying to move on and do other things. Do you find that this particular film has taken you down a road that you did not expect in terms of people's attachment to it and reaction to it when you've shown it in front of people? Have people used it for advocacy in any way to change policy?
That last part, not so much. I mean, I made a film before about the flower industry in Kenya, and that was like, it won an award on Doc Leipzig, and that was given by the European Union. So they distributed that film to all the ministries of labor in the European Union. So that's really, you know, an example of how a documentary can really influence the policy. With this film, of course, a lot of all the topics are universal, but a lot of the specific problems are really typically Dutch. The fact that you get a fine, the fact about the competition. So I don't have proof or anything that those rules have changed, except of the few that I mentioned before about really in the shepherding business. But what you say about living with the project, it's one of the reasons I didn't make a new film yet. because it's really a film takes you down, and then your film is finished, and then you, I mean, 2 years later, I'm still, you know, talking about it, and that's really nice for me. It's also a way to build off because some directors really they do more projects at the same time, but for me that's why I also produce, because that I can do, but not really go full 100% of your own directing film, and then it just takes a lot from you, yeah, physically, mentally, and it's also the success. It's really nice, but it doesn't bring any money in, but it does take a lot of time. So that's.
So do you know even or know how many film festivals this film was in?
This film.
Yeah.
I know, because I've been sending them all myself, okay. Which takes a very long time. And but I get more easy in it. No, so it's 90. So about 90. And if people don't know about festivals, they think, oh, that's not too much. Or how much work can that be? Well, it can be a lot of work. I visited like 20 last year, so that's a lot of time off as well. But also now it's getting better. But before I was in contact with a festival, and then you had sometimes 10 people emailing me, one of print traffic, one of, you know, but on the other side it was all me. So it was like, me answering those 10 people. So that for people that don't know about it, it can be quite a full-time job.
What is the trajectory of the film going forward? Where are we in the life of it?
I thought it was over a year ago, and it's still continuing, but I don't know. I don't expect big things at all, because what I know is that documentaries are lifespan is really short. You first have a year of a premiere, then when that year is over, for a lot of festivals it's already old, so it's, you know, then afterwards maybe some television, but I think it's almost finished. But the film, that's a nice thing of why I like making films. I mean, you really put so much love and effort in it, but it stays there forever, eh? You can watch it forever, and but it's not, it's really hard nowadays. I mean, I'm really honored and happy that my film is doing so well. And often, I mean, also with this festival, there are only seven or documentaries, I think, or 10.
In this one?
Yeah. In the future competition. Sorry?
No, 30-something.
In the future competition of documentaries? Yeah. Okay. Well, some festivals, they only have 10 or 6. And then, you know, I'm a Dutch guy I made the film almost by myself. And then to be among those people that I was already admiring as a young guy, with Nicolas Gerhalter, with films that are Viktor Kosakowski, a million budget films, with executive producers Leonardo DiCaprio, Sea of Shadows. And then being in a competition with them and then win, you know, that's amazing.
So we're going to have to wrap it up soon. So audience, if you have any questions, this is your time. But you know, I was curious about, you said you shot this yourself too, right? The cinematography is really spectacular. What role did sort of look and feel play in your conception of how to tell this story? Did you think about that when you were shooting it? I mean, it's almost like a character in and of itself.
Yeah. Well, to make a film like this in the Netherlands, you have to write a script of 60, 70 pages. I don't know if that's the same in the US. And of course you don't know what happened, but I also wrote a lot of the things I thought about cinematography, because I didn't want to tell a romantic story about a shepherd. I wanted to show the real life. And that's not when people often see the shepherd, when they go outside and the sun is shining, but they don't go out when it's really freezing or raining. And so I didn't want the sun to shine only in the beginning. So except those cinematography I did, I thought about the lens I wanted to use. And I also did the grading myself and also some special effects. So in the beginning, I put some more sunbeams in. And later, for example, people asked me, what drone did you use to fly in the snow? And I said, it wasn't snowing. So I let it snow in the post-production. And that's always too expensive for a documentary. So, so if you want to do that, you have to do it yourself.
Well, I mean, it was beautiful. I mean, the story, you know, is compelling, is challenging for us all, but what the film is visually beautiful as well. And, you know, I'm thanking you for submitting it to us because, you know, I know what kind of work that is to just have to deal with festivals. And we probably, hopefully didn't have too many people bombarding you, but I'm very happy that we're able to share this with this audience. I know that people who come to the Woods Hole Film Festival, we often show films here, interestingly enough, with similar kinds of stories about similar issues, you know, sort of individuals who are really trying to take a stand for themselves and keep a way of life alive in the face of incredible odds. So I know that our audience will really appreciate and be grateful that you've shared this story with us. And, you know, I'm hopeful that in some small way we can play a part in making people understand the importance of supporting individuals, whether filmmakers or shepherds or anybody else who's really trying to make sure that we all have the opportunity to live how we want to live. So I'm going to say thank you for being with us. We'll let you head off to bed. Audience, thank you very much. And we hope that if you haven't seen the film yet, you'll watch it. It is available through August 1st. And please vote. And somebody just said she loved it. Thank you. Please vote in the platform. And we will see everybody hopefully at the award ceremony on August 2nd. Well, we won't see you. You'll see us live streaming on Facebook. So thank you, Ton, very much. And
thank you so much for having me. And I think because it's only the second day, people still have to see the film and they still have the chance. Yes. So please do. And thank you so much for having me, and good luck with the rest of the festival.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.